Sustainability has indeed bottled up the agenda during the pandemic. What has really changed?
Well, I think that people have begun to really see anecdotally the evidence of climate change. It's one thing for scientists to come up with Keeling curves and to show how atmospheric CO2 comes, but when we see catastrophic events, ice storms today in Chile, typhoons, tsunamis, drought, excessive rains, hurricanes, this anecdotal evidence really adds fuel to the fire. Ever since, you know, the 80s, I'm told that every Hurricane Hugo in the 80s, that was a once in a 100-year event. Then there's the next Hurricane Andrew in the 90s. That's a one in a 100-year event. Then there are earthquakes that are one in a 100. So in the last 50 years, there's been a one in a 100-year event. So either the math is wrong, or maybe those events are becoming more extreme.
In the finance circle these days, we hear the phrase environmental finance a lot more now. And you were actually a pioneer in environmental finance. Tell us, what is your vision? Are things moving in the right direction and at the right pace?
I think they are moving in the right direction. I think that we are beginning to see worldwide recognition. We're particularly seeing thought-out events here in North America where environmental open interest is at record levels. People are looking at California and the Northeast and renewable energy certificates. Open interest and trading volume is at record levels in Europe. China promises to begin emissions trading in June. And I think the forces are really aligned to herald in enormous change. And the word environmental finance didn't exist. 30 years ago, when I taught a course at Columbia University, and the dean asked me, well, what are you going to call it? I said, let's call it environmental finance. And from there came a magazine and came a whole field that many people are now considering a profession unto itself.
Let's now make it a little bit more tangible for where investors needs to make decision and invest in companies. Globally, how can the industry make ESG ratings more credible?
I think that this is very important because if we look at the analogy of grain trading and standardization, the price signal generates behavioral changes like planting more crops or building grain elevators. I think that ESG has a rough measure, and I am 700 years old, so I worked on the first sustainability index at a company called SAM, a Swiss mutual fund. And it was a very rough model. You know, we tried to figure best in class, we rewarded diversity, we gave you less points if you polluted, we picked best in class. That was sold to the Dow Jones and is now the DJSI. But that index was very imperfect. We now have the ability to refine it. And once you take the argument, not necessarily to only the HR department, but you put it in the hands of the CFO, behavior changes. It's a very different thing to walk into a company and say, stop polluting. It's another thing to walk into the CFO and say, I can show you how to increase your profits. That's a very different approach.
Yes, indeed, because we have also seen that some companies globally that are considered probably less green, making to the top of ESG rankings. Well, I guess with more disclosure, better disclosure, and technology being able to translate many of the indicators, investors may be better equipped to look and evaluate each cases.
And in the markets, though, markets have eyes. You know, they see, and markets have ears, they hear. And you see reflected in volume and pricings that things you don't understand until after the event passes. So you have to watch the eyes and ears of markets.